Okay, so let us discuss the spectrum and bandwidth for 5G new radio, which we had actually discussed. So this diagram, we had seen that 5G supports lower side of band, which is below 1 gigahertz. Let me take the pointer. Below 1 gigahertz for coverage purpose. And there you already have a lot of mobile systems working on that, 800, 900 megahertz. You have GSM, CDMA and all. And then between 1 gigahertz to 6 gigahertz, it is mid-band. This is also supported by 5G. And then you also support millimeter wave in 5G for high capacity requirement, a small cell deployment. We had discussed this slide, so it's a kind of a recap. This also, I had discussed, yeah.
Slide nahi dikh rahi.
Others can confirm. Is my slide coming?
It is visible. It is visible.
Visible. Sir, your bandwidth issue, sir, you can either reconnect or try to have better bandwidth.
Okay. It is okay now.
Yeah, so because of bandwidth, it will come slow for you. So if you use wired broadband, it will be better. So as I had explained that WRC19, World Radio Communication Conference, which happens every 4 years, they had identified various band for IMT, especially for 5G deployment. So in 24 gigahertz, around 24 gigahertz, then around 37, 43 gigahertz, 45, 47 gigahertz, 47, 48 gigahertz, 66 to 71 gigahertz. So in fact, prior to WRC19, total band which was meant for IMT, that is mobile, was only 1.9 gigahertz. Whereas with these bands, it has become 17.25 bands. A large chunk of spectrum was now allocated by ITU, WRC, for IMT, that is International Mobile Telecommunication, which includes all technology. So these bands will primarily be used by 5G, but when ITU allocates, it says IMT. It doesn't say that it is for 2G, 3G and all. That is done by the respective specification making bodies like 3GPP, which we'll discuss. So now when 3GPP rolled out specifications for 5G new radio in release 15 and release 16. So there have been two releases so far, release 15 and release 16. On 17 onwards, work is going on. So they said that there are two frequency range. What they defined is frequency range one, and then frequency range two. Frequency range one is from 450 megahertz to 7.125 gigahertz. This doesn't mean that all the frequency chunk available between these two are available. So there are different bands defined within this range, which is there in the next slide, and I had discussed in the previous one also. Similarly, FR2 they have defined is from 24.25 to 52.6 gigahertz. So basically, if you look at ITU, ITU has gone beyond this, but as far as 3GPP is concerned, up to release 16, 17, they may define more. So these bands were already existing. Most of these bands were already existing for say 4G or 3G, which can now be used for 5G also. And there has been certain new bands allocated. Those new bands are these. It is called N78, N79, N77, which is, this is between 3.3 to 3.8 gigahertz. This is 4.4 to 5 gigahertz and so on. Similarly, on FR2, these four bands are defined, N258, 257, 261 and 262 in different, you can see 37 gigahertz to 40 gigahertz, 24.25 gigahertz to 27.5 gigahertz. So these are the frequency band actually defined by 3GPP. And if you want to see in detail the entire band which is available for 5G, this is the chart which we had shown earlier, where certain bands were already there for 4G, 3G, which can be reformed and used for 5G. And there are certain new bands. So particularly the mid bands, three bands in the mid band range and four in high band millimeter wave side, they have identified. And if you look at these frequencies, some of the bands are FDD band, some of the bands are TDD band, and there are certain bands which are especially for supplementary uplink, SUL, you can see here, that in uplink side, these frequencies can be used, especially to increase the upload speed and other requirement. So these are the frequency, different frequency band, which has been allocated by 3GPP. So as I explained that the sub gigahertz band will be for coverage layer. 1 gigahertz to 6 gigahertz, that is mid band, is capacity layer, and then coverage, macro coverage. And then the small cell, which is beyond 6 gigahertz and up to 100 gigahertz, these are small cells for high throughput, extreme capacity requirement. And the bandwidth also, we had discussed that in FR1 and FR2, 3GPP has defined different bandwidth which can be used in 5G. So minimum bandwidth required is 5 megahertz in FR1, and then 10 megahertz, 15 megahertz, 20 megahertz, and it can continue up to 100 megahertz in FR1. FR1 is below 7 gigahertz. And then in FR2, the minimum difference is 50 megahertz, and it can go up to 400 megahertz. So the maximum bandwidth which can be used in 5G is 400 megahertz. And is 400 megahertz, and then not all devices to support all these FR1 and FR2, they can support part of it, because it's a very high range, it will be difficult to produce devices supporting the entire range, and all type of devices may not require that. So not all devices need to support the entire FR1 and FR2. Okay, so now let us discuss different waveform and modulations. Before I proceed, I may request you that let us recap what kind of waveform or modulation we have, or what kind of access we had in 2G and 3G and 4G before we proceed to the 5G. So can any one of you tell me that in 2G, what kind of multiplexing we were using? Maybe any one of you can open the mic and tell me.
Yeah, Sanjay here. In 2G, we had, say in GSM, we had TDMA with FDM. And I think it was GMSK modulation.
You are right. And somebody else can tell me what was there in the 3G? What kind of multiple access we were having in 3G?
Wideband CDMA.
Yeah, so it was CDMA, wideband CDMA, right? And somebody can tell me about 4G?
In 4G, it was CPOMA in downlink.
Right, very right, that it was cyclic prefix OFDMA. So 5G also, it's same with slight difference, which we'll discuss, but 5G also, it is same. So what we have is orthogonal frequency division multiplexing as a waveform in 5G. So when we say orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, what does this means? Can anybody tell me?
Subcarriers are orthogonally separated.
Yeah, subcarriers are orthogonally separated. Anyone else want to add onto this?
It means where we have peak of one subcarrier, at that point, all other subcarriers will add to zero.
You're right. So there'll be a null point when there is a peak of one subcarrier. There'll be null point of all other subcarriers and their side. So So you are right. So basically what is done in OFDM is that suppose you have 50 megahertz bandwidth. So what you do is that out of 50 megahertz, small part in kilohertz from both sides as a guard band you remove, and whatever balance you get, you divide into small chunk of subcarriers. For example, in 4G, the subcarrier spacing was 15 kilohertz. So what you do is that 50 megahertz, just reduce the guard band from both sides, a very small piece, and then divide by 15 kilohertz. So that much number of subcarrier you get. So here what you see delta F is nothing but subcarrier spacing in kilohertz or in frequency domain, right? So you have multiple subcarrier 1, subcarrier 2, subcarrier 3. And then what happens is that when you have one subcarrier for this much duration, suppose for this much duration, what happens is that even beyond this duration, you'll have the same frequency but with lower amplitude, kind of a side lobe or something like that will continue. Please allow me to take one call. मैं मीटिंग में था. हेलो, मीटिंग मीटिंग चल रहा. मैं अभी पढ़ा रहा हूँ, बाद में कॉल करूंगा आपको. सॉरी. ओके, सो इफ यू जस्ट लुक हेयर द पीक ऑफ दिस सब कैरियर एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम ऑल अदर कैरियर्स हेयर इट इज नल. So this is how orthogonality works, that whenever you have peak, you have null of all other subcarriers. So there is no interference. And can anybody tell me what kind of modulation we use in 5G or 4G?
Modulation is QAM.
Yes, you are right. And so 5G new radio, we support QAM modulation. So it starts from 4 QAM, 16 QAM, 64 QAM, and up to 256 QAM. So this is kind of up to release 16, which has been released, 15 and 16. So they have defined up to 256 QAM, but in subsequent releases, it can be increased to it can go up to say 1024 QAM modulation also. But up to release 16, it is 256 QAM maximum, which has been defined in the specification of 5G new radio. For those who are not very much familiar, so we all know that how a frequency division multiplexing works. In frequency division multiplexing, we just divide the part of the bandwidth in a small kind of a subcarrier. But here what we used to do is that we keep some guard band after every chunk of this small frequencies. But in OFDMA, this guard band is not required because of the orthogonality we get, and it becomes more subcarriers. So this is one of the difference. And then as I discussed about modulation, so just a recap that I think all of us have read somewhere about all these modulations. So if you look at amplitude modulation, what you do is that when you transmit a frequency, so the amplitude, suppose one binary one is to be transmitted, then you have this much amplitude. If binary zero is to be transmitted, then your amplitude is less, and so on. So this is kind of an amplitude modulation. In case of a frequency modulation, you change the frequency. For one, you have one frequency. For zero, you have other frequency. So on the receiver side, depending upon what frequency it is able to receive, it can decode these binaries. And in phase modulation, you change the phase. For example, one is represented like this, but when it is zero, then it is starting from here, a different phase 180 degree kind of, and so on. So you can do a phase modulation. You can also add amplitude and phase. So that is called amplitude and phase modulation together. So QAM is quadrature amplitude modulation. So there you also have phase and you also have amplitude. So combined together, you are able to drive different kind of QAM. So for example, just for a purpose of an example, let me take a pen. So if I have like this axis, so what I can do is my wave can be at 0 degree, 90 degree, 180, or anywhere. So basically what you do is, if this represents amplitude, which is say same everywhere, but the phase will be different. So here phase is different. So this is 0 degree, this may be a 45 degree, this may be 90, and then whatever. So you can have different phases, and every phase can represent one number or more than one number. So you can have various phases and then amplitude and phases, and combined together it becomes quadrature amplitude modulation. So various kind of QAM possible is here. If it is QPSK, quadrature phase shift keying, so here what you have is that every state of that frequency will represent 2 bits, right? So in BPSK binary phase shift keying, you only have 2 states, either 0 or 1. So one symbol will contain only 1 bit. In QPSK, every symbol can contain 2 bit, because you are using multiple phases here. So 2 bit per symbol. In 16 QAM, what happens is that you have 16 states. So it will be represented by 4 bit per symbol. 4 bit per symbol. Every symbol will have 4 bit. Can anybody tell me what is symbol, so that it is clear to every one of you? Any one of you can tell me that what is symbol?
Symbols in the context of QAM, it will be one point of the constellation matrix, like a particular combination of R and theta. It will be one symbol which we say symbol rate or baud rate.
Right. So, and in a layman language, suppose you have a subcarrier, right? So you may have a like this, and you are transmitting it for a time, say delta t, right? So during this time, which is called symbol duration, during this time, if you are using say QPSK, so you'll be able to transmit 2 bits within this time. If you are using say 16 QAM, then within this time, this wave can actually carry 4 bit kind of. Similarly, if you are using 32 QAM, then it is 5 bits. It can carry 5 bits, and so on. So basically, within the same symbol duration, you can have 2 bit of data, 4 bit of data, or 5 bit of data, or 6 bit of data, depending upon order of modulation. So symbol is basically a period in which how many bits you are able to carry on the same. Suppose this is a subcarrier being transmitted for a delta t. So within, and if that delta t I can say as a symbol period, so within that symbol period and that particular subcarrier, how much bit I can transmit. In a layman language, this is the understanding. Hope it is clear.
Sir, is it related to sample rate, sir? Is it related to sample rate, so that we can take more samples and then send the exact amplitude?
Yes. So you are right. So if you increase order of modulation, your samples required would be more, right?
Better representation.
We'll discuss about that. How sampling is done and all. We'll discuss that, right? Okay. So I had explained that up to 256 QAM. So how many bits will be there in the 256 QAM? I have not mentioned here.
8 bits.
8 bits, because 8 bits. The power 8 is 256. So basically there will be a 256 state of that particular waveform during that delta t time, and every state in terms of phase and amplitude will define 8 bits. And here a representation has been given for 16 QAM that every point will have kind of a 4 bit, starting from, say, if this is the state, then when you decode, you'll say that it is 0000001 and so on. So this is how they form this particular constellation diagram. Okay, so now suppose a simplified OFDM system. How do you make a simplified OFDM system? So suppose you have a data which is to be transmitted. Let me write any data. This could be 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, and so on. And let us assume that we are using 4 QAM modulation. So when I'm saying 4 QAM modulation means what? How many bits per symbol?
2.
2 bits. So what I do is that this is a kind of a serial data. So I have to make it parallel because I have many subcarriers, and every subcarrier in a particular time duration can carry one symbol. So it is 4 QAM is 2 bit I will arrange. I'll take 2 bits each. And suppose I have 4 subcarriers for this example. What I'll do is I'll take the, it is coming serially. So I'm taking the bits from here, but you assume that this bit came first, and then these 2 bits came and these 2 bits came. So I'm taking this 0, 1 here, and then you have 1, 0. Kind of I'm making the serial data into a, again 1, 0, then I have 0, 1, and then 1, 1, and so on. 1, 2, 3, suppose I have 5 subcarriers. So I will modulate this on the subcarrier, depending upon what phase and carrier frequency I have. Although I am making it in a similar way, but please see that the phases are different. Just can assume that phases are different corresponding to these numbers. So what I have done is I have created this kind of a serial digital data into a parallel data. May I request to kindly switch off your mic? Somebody mic is on. And then all of us have read fast Fourier transform and all. So basically what now we want to do is that we want to combine these through a process called IFFT, inverse of fast Fourier transform. So when you do fast Fourier transform, basically you are combining all these subcarriers into one carrier. Something like that will come depending upon how the data is there, and this will be transmitted onto the receiver side. Onto the receiver side, when this will be received, we'll do reverse of it. So we'll do kind of, here it was inverse FFT, I'll do FFT. And then what I'll get this again parallel data I'll be able to decode, and then I convert this into the serial data. So this is how a very, very simplified OFDM system works. So I'm not going into much detail, but this is a simplified way. There will be many other things in between which I have not discussed. So if you look at in a diagram form, it looks like this, that you have those QAM modulation, and then you do IFFT, and then you get a time domain sum of all these carriers, and this will look like this. And onto the receiver side, we do reverse of it, and you get back the data. This is how we actually do an OFDM system. I'll also share one detailed literature on it, which gives much more detail. If somebody want to read, they can read. I'll share one document on OFDM. Okay, now most important part is the numerologies. So let us discuss about numerologies, 5G new radio numerologies, what it is. So what is numerology in 5G is that we had discussed that in 4G, the subcarrier spacing is 15 kilohertz. But in 5G, the subcarrier spacing is depending upon what numerology we are using. the subcarrier spacing is defined. So how it is defined is like this. The formula for subcarrier spacing is 2 to the power mu into 15 kilohertz. So, and mu is a numerology. It can be 0, it can be 1, it can be 2, 3, 4, up to release 16. These 5 numerology from 0 to 4 are defined. So, if somebody can calculate for me, if I have numerology 0, which is 2 to the power 0 into 15 kilohertz, how much I'll get?
15 kilohertz.
And if I have numerology 1, that is 2 to the power 1 into 15, then how much I'll get?
30.
You'll get 30 kilohertz. And then if I have numerology 2, that is 2 to the power 2 into 15, how much I get?
8 into
16.
60 kilohertz. And then if you again do 2 to the power 3, it will be 120 kilohertz. And then you can have 240 kilohertz. So these are different numerology. When we say numerology 3, so I am trying to say that subcarrier spacing I am using is 120 kilohertz. If I say numerology 0, so that means I am using 15 kilohertz subcarrier spacing. So this is how numerology is defined, and we'll see the various usage scenario. So this I discussed. So although in up to release 15 and 16, this much is defined, but there is an possibility that I can have this mu, somewhere it is also written as n, as say minus 1 or minus 2. So when I have minus 1, it will be 7.5 kilohertz. If I have minus 2, it will come 3.75 kilohertz. So basically, it is for a narrow band applications like IoT. In LTE, it was there. LTE narrow band IoT, this 3.75 kilohertz subcarrier spacing was used. So in future, perhaps even the 5G will evolve for minus 1 and minus 2. Similarly, you can also have n is equal to 5, which will come 480 kilohertz, because all the design of 5G has been based on 480 kilohertz, although up to release 16, so they have defined up to 240 kilohertz only. So now let us make a calculation. Please help me. Somebody can open the calculator in your mobile and calculate that how many subcarriers I may have in a 50 megahertz bandwidth. So let us do that. So let us assume that subcarrier spacing is 30 kilohertz, bandwidth I have 50 megahertz. And I'm also telling you that for 50 megahertz bandwidth and 30 kilohertz subcarrier spacing, specification has defined 692.5 kilohertz as a guard band. So what if you have this particular frequency like this? So from this side, you have to remove 692, and from this side also. So twice of 692.5 kilohertz, you have to subtract from 50 megahertz, and then you divide by 30 kilohertz. So can somebody tell me that how much subcarrier I can get? First of all, let somebody calculate the effective bandwidth, that is reduce this guard band, and then I'll have effective bandwidth. Can somebody tell me how much it is coming? Any one of you?
49.308.
If somebody is getting something else, he should point it out, megahertz. Right. Now you have effective. Pardon?
It's 48.615.
You should not get so many. We have to just reduce 692.5 twice from 50, and then you put three zeros because it is in megahertz. This is in kilohertz.
Seven.
Which one is correct?
617.
48.615 is the right answer?
615, sir.
Okay. So now let us divide this by 30 kilohertz. So this is in kilohertz, so you can put three zeros or can take that, right? So that you get correct number. Tell me how much we are getting.
1620.
So we are getting 1620's number of sub carriers. 1620 SCs. So I think there is okay. So you may be right. I have calculated it perhaps for 15 kilohertz. So you are right. Yes, you are right. If this was 15 kilohertz subcarrier spacing, then perhaps you'll get 3241. Okay, so now we know that how to calculate subcarrier. So now, what is a resource block? What is a physical resource block? So basically, now you have subcarriers. A chunk of subcarriers will be called resource block. In 4G, it was 12 subcarriers. In 5G also, it is 12 subcarriers. So 12 contiguous subcarriers. Not that you can take subcarrier from one place and other subcarrier from other place. It has to be contiguous. So contiguous 12 subcarriers is called resource block. Sometime they also call it PRB, physical resource block. Please remember this. So let us calculate resource block. So basically, just see here that, as I said, that the 12 subcarriers is equal to one resource block. So we'll calculate bandwidth of a resource block. So suppose I have 15 kilohertz. Numerology 0 means 15 kilohertz. 15 kilohertz subcarrier spacing. And if I have to calculate bandwidth of resource block, so that is 12 such subcarriers. So into 12, how much bandwidth I'll get? Can somebody tell me?
180 kilohertz.
180 kilohertz. So this was the case in even 4G. But in 5G, I also have numerology 1, which is 30 kilohertz. And here, if I calculate bandwidth of a resource block, which is 12 subcarriers. So here, your subcarrier spacing has doubled, but 12 subcarrier will be one resource block. So what will be the bandwidth of one resource block?
360 kilohertz.
And then for numerology 2, how much it will come?
60 kilohertz
is 720 kilohertz. 720 kilohertz. And for this, numerology 3?
1440.
And then for the last one?
2880
kilohertz. So now you have different bandwidth in frequency domain for different resource block, right? Okay, so if you see visually, so this is your 15 kilohertz. So if you see frequency domain vertical side, so your bandwidth is only this much, right? But if it is 30 kilohertz, then your bandwidth is 360 kilohertz. If it is 60, then you have 720 and so on. So basically, on the frequency domain, you are using larger chunk of kind of a bandwidth per subcarrier, per resource block. Okay, so let us calculate now number of resource block. Let us calculate number of resource block. Let me give you one example. I have bandwidth of 100 megahertz. Subcarrier spacing is 60 kilohertz. Guard band is 1370 for this. It is given in the spec. Now, our aim is to calculate number of RBs. Let somebody calculate the effective bandwidth. So subtract 1370 twice from 100 megahertz and tell me what bandwidth we get. Any one of you?
97.26.
So it is 97.26 megahertz, right? So now I have to calculate number of subcarriers. So number of subcarriers will be how much? This effective bandwidth divided by, now I have 60 kilohertz subcarrier spacing divided by 60. How much I get?
1621.
Pardon?
1621
number of subcarriers you get. And to calculate number of RB, what we have to do? We have to divide by 12. So just divide it by 12. How much we get?
135.
Okay, so just see that with 100 megahertz bandwidth and 60 kilowatt subcarrier spacing, maximum I can have 135 resource blocks, RBs. You're right, your answer is correct. Okay, so now this is a table given, this is given in the specification itself, which tells that for different numerology and how much minimum RBs are required and how much maximum RBs are required. Specifications have given that in case for different numerology, for 15 kilohertz, minimum resource block required is 24. And maximum 275. So what will be the minimum bandwidth? So this 24 into 12 number of subcarrier into 15 kilohertz. If you calculate, how much bandwidth you get? Can somebody do it for me? So minimum required is 24. So 24 RB means 24 into 12 subcarriers and it is 15 kilohertz. So how much bandwidth I get?
4.32 megahertz.
Yes, you can see here 4.32 megahertz, right? And maximum is 275. So again, if you do this, 275 into 12 into 15, so you get 49.5 megahertz. So basically, you can see that if you are using, so what it says that if you are using 15 kilohertz, then minimum bandwidth required is 4.32. So their bandwidth, if you look at the table of bandwidth, it was 5 megahertz minimum one. So we require 5 megahertz minimum because minimum 24 RBs will be required. And maximum is 275 here, so 50 megahertz. So this tells clearly that between these two bandwidth, you can use 15 kilohertz. You cannot use it beyond this. This is one of the. Now let us see one more. That let us assume 30 kilohertz. In 30 kilohertz, the minimum bandwidth required is 8.64, maximum 99. So 30 kilohertz subcarrier spacing you can only use when you have at least 8.64, that means 10 megahertz bandwidth, and here 99 means 100 megahertz. If you have bandwidth more than 100 megahertz, you cannot use 30 kilohertz subcarrier spacing. So this clearly tells that in FR1, our bandwidth was up to 50 megahertz. Sorry, 100 megahertz. So up to 100 megahertz, you can use either 15 kilohertz or you can use 30 kilohertz as of now. Now, if you look at 60 kilohertz, so minimum bandwidth required is 17. Sorry. And maximum 198. I hope you have understood this particular table and the concept that which subcarrier spacing will be used in which, what kind of bandwidth if I have. So for example, 240 kilohertz subcarrier here 397.44, that is 400 megahertz bandwidth maximum one in FR2, which we have seen. So this is how different subcarrier spacing will be used in different bandwidth which we may have.
Sir, what is the reason of for a question?
What is the,
what is the reason of having that maximum limit on the RB? What limits that?
So basically, the one of the important reason was that it has to be made compatible with the LTE, because there we had 12 kind of RBs and it has to interwork. So that was one reason. Secondly, if you go to the frame structure wherein if you want to use the same times, I mean, so what happens is the symbol duration decreases when we go higher in the numerology. So what happens is that you are increasing on the frequency side because your subcarrier spacing is higher, but on time domain you are reducing, right? You are reducing half. I'll discuss that with you. So within a smaller duration, you can pack more data, and it is important for latency sensitive applications. So they have kept this 12 as a standard also to take care of that particular alignment. I think when I go forward in the session, you will understand better.
Okay.
So so here this table is also taken from the specifications, which tells that here you have given bandwidth, you have subcarrier spacing. So minimum guard band they have defined. So maximum RB is possible is 270. We had calculated earlier. So if you calculate this, how you'll calculate? You'll just reduce the guard band, divide by subcarrier spacing. So you'll get 270. We had done this calculation, 270 maximum number of RBs. Similarly, if you have 100 megahertz and you are using 30 kilo subcarrier spacing, you get 273, and here you get 135 calculation we had done, if you recall. So this is how it is calculated. So since we have done calculations, you are aware of it, right? And this is the way we calculated. Whatever way we calculated, it is also given in the text. If somebody has any doubt, he can read. I'll give you the PPT so that how to calculate RB and all. If you have any doubt, you can read and calculate yourself. And then let us discuss a various relation between spectrum band, subcarrier spacing, and cell size, etc. So just see this diagram, that here on this side I am writing frequency, different frequency, 700 megahertz, 3 to 5 gigahertz. Then this is unlicensed band, 6 gigahertz, because 5G supports even unlicensed band. And here I am writing millimeter, 28 gigahertz. This is not a rule, this is an example. So just see the example. So in the lower side of the frequency, if your frequency is low, so use case will be coverage, will be outdoor macro coverage, right? So cell size will be your bigger. And if you have bigger cell size, then you have to use smaller subcarrier spacing, 15 kilohertz, right? Otherwise, what will happen is that it will create a problem of inter-symbol interference, ISI more, right? In case you have, say, mid-band, 3 to 5 gigahertz, then this is mainly for outdoor macro coverage or small cell. And here we will be using, say, 30 kilohertz subcarrier spacing and the carrier bandwidth of 100 megahertz. Here carrier bandwidth, smaller bandwidth can be used in the this kind of scenario. So here the cell size is slightly less. It is not very big. And it is a mid-band and 30 kilo subcarrier spacing. If it is indoor coverage, so I can use even unlicensed band in place of Wi-Fi. I can have indoor 5G base station. So here I'll be using, say, 60 kilohertz subcarrier spacing, and maybe I can have up to 160 megahertz of bandwidth, availability of the bandwidth here. And in millimeter, I can use it for a small cell. I can have, say, 400 megahertz carrier bandwidth and 120 kilohertz subcarrier spacing. So this is the relation of spectrum band, subcarrier spacing, and cell size. If your cell size is less, you will use higher subcarrier spacing. If your cell size is more, you'll be using lower subcarrier spacing. And even the bandwidth, so onto the lower side, you don't have much bandwidth, actually. Availability of a spectrum in the lower band is also very scarce, so bandwidth will be less there.
Here in this unlicensed band, this 3GPP had not defined 160 megahertz carrier.
Yeah, I mean, so there is also concept. You are right. So basically, this was just an example. So whatever is bandwidth is defined will only be used in 5G. So that was just an example I have taken from some website. So don't go on that. I said this is not the exact. This is just an example.
Okay. No, means for unlicensed operations also 3GPP has specified everything like channel bandwidth and all.
Yeah. So basically, for I mean, what they have said is that they will support even the those spectrum which is unlicensed. So up till 4G, you know, so even the specification doesn't define that. Here it has been defined in 5G.
Okay.
So they have just said unlicensed band. So bandwidth and all will be as per the actual thing. Okay. So now the same thing let us understand in this pictorial diagram, that how subcarrier spacing, bandwidth, latency and cell size is there. So just see here. So onto the x-axis, I'm showing the spectrum. So here it is sub 1 gigahertz, then mid band, and then here high band. So this is a mid band, high band, very high band, and this is the low band. And onto the x-axis, on the right side, I have latency. Onto the left side, I have cell size. So basically, if you use 15 kilohertz, you can of course have large cell size, but if you prefer, you can also have smaller cell size and more smaller cell size in 15 kilohertz. But if your cell size is large, so that means signal has to go a larger distance and come back. So your latency will be kind of a medium. If you have with same 15 kilohertz, you have a smaller cell size, you have planned a smaller cell size, then your latency will be, say, low. And if you have very, very small size cell using this 15 kilohertz, then you have a very low latency. But normally, then you'll be wasting a spectrum in lower band, which can give you coverage. And if you have planned a very smaller size, so there'll be disadvantage. Now let's see the 30 kilohertz. So 30 and we are looking at low band. So low band, I'll definitely use 15 kilohertz. I can vary the cell size in 15 kilohertz depending upon the requirement. And then onto the lower side, I can also use 30 kilohertz. So if I use 30 kilohertz for medium kind of cell coverage, then my latency will be low. And if I have a smaller cell size, then latency will be very low. And if I have, I can also use 60 kilohertz. So there also latency will be very, very low. So now, if you have a medium spectrum on medium band, so there for larger coverage, of course, you can use 30 kilohertz, slightly larger, not very big as the lower side. Then you have a low latency. And if you have a smaller size, then you have lower, and then in 60 kilohertz you'll have a very, very less latency, and so on. So basically this is how they would be utilizing different frequency band with different subcarrier spacing for their need of latency and cell size. So this will be a permutation combination by the operators depending upon what they require. So now we are coming to the frame structure in time domain. This is very, very important. We have 6-7 minutes. So shall we go ahead or shall we have discussion and close for today? Can somebody tell me? I can go for frame structure to some extent in next 6-7 minutes. Any one of you can just tell me whether shall we go forward or shall we just have discussion if you have any question.
I think discussion would be better, Ashok, because the concepts which you have taught today, they are quite, involved.
Yeah. So if any one of you have some question, you can ask, or if there's no question, I'll go 6-7 minutes on frame structure, and maybe I can repeat this in the next session also for the benefit of all.
No, here a user will be allotted minimum an RB.
Yeah, so RB becomes a basic unit, you are right. So how much is allocated, I'll discuss when I'll discuss frame structure and all exact one. But yes, RB becomes an unit.
Okay.
Okay, so
latency, Ashok, this latency and all, everything is dependent on the bandwidth, which you showed in the last slide.
Subcarrier spacing. So I'll just tell you, sir, what happens that if you use subcarrier spacing of, say, 30 kilohertz, then your if you use, suppose, 15 kilohertz, then what in 15 kilohertz symbol duration is 1 millisecond, right, sir? And slot size is 1 millisecond. For 30 kilohertz, slot size is half 0.5 millisecond. That means within 0.5 milliseconds, your data. So when you do scheduling, sir, you do slot wise. Normally, suppose some data is coming, which is to be transmitted. So it is transmitted in a slot. So suppose a slot is ongoing. So it will wait for the next slot and then it will be given the chance to transmit the data if resources are available. So there will be, if I'm using, say, 15 kilohertz, so only after 1 millisecond, it gets a chance. But if I'm using 30 kilohertz, the duration of time slot is half, that is 0.5 millisecond. So within 0.5 millisecond, my data can go. If I'm using 60 kilohertz, it is again half, 0.25 millisecond. So my data can be transmitted in next 0.25 milliseconds. I need not wait 1 millisecond. So that's how latency increases. I mean, it becomes better when you go higher in the numerology.
So
am I clear, sir?
Yeah, that point is clear. But my question is, in normal, 3G, 4G, the profile of the subscriber is, the subscriber will say, I want 10 Mbps download, for example. So so he will be allowed that from the operation center. In this case, whether the user will specify that I want so much latency, and according to that, the spacing will be decided, or how it will be?
So there are two ways, sir. So one way is that what services I have subscribed to. So there are certain services which require better latency. If I have subscribed to a service which demands a particular latency, so when resources are allocated to me, so I'll be allocated resources based on what I have subscribed to. So for example, I discussed about different network slice. So then suppose there is a network slice meant for a particular service having a required quality of service. Quality of service will be in terms of latency and other things. So the access to that slide is only to those customers who have actually subscribed those services. So it is based on subscription, number one, and based on also what is available, right?
Okay.
So of course, a user has to subscribe. For plain vanilla internet, they will not define the various quality of service parameter. It will be on best effort basis. But if I have, suppose I have subscribed to some guaranteed rate, for example, if you take certain services nowadays, they define you that how much speed you'll be getting and what is the total chunk of data you can download in a particular period. So after you have consumed, your data rate gets reduced. So even in 4G, it is happening. So it is all depends upon your subscription and availability in the network. So even if you subscribe for, say, 100 Mbps, and if the resources onto the radio is not available, it cannot be given. So it is subscription as well as the resource availability, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Okay, so we have 2 minutes. I'll just quickly start, and maybe we can do it again. So basically, let us understand what is a frame. In 4G, the frame size, this I am drawing in a time domain, frame size was 10 millisecond. The frame size in 4G was 10 millisecond. The frame size on 4G, 10 millisecond. In 5G also, it is 10 millisecond. Now this frame will contain subframes. So there will be 10 subframes, 0, 1, 2, and up to 9. So that means one subframe becomes how much? 1 millisecond, right? And then this particular subframe will have slot. So the slot size can be 1 millisecond, can be half of it, 0.5 millisecond, can be 0.25, and so on, depending upon subcarrier spacing. If it is 15 kilohertz, then it is 1. If it is 30 kilohertz, then 0.5, 60 kilohertz, then 0.25, and so on. And then in every slot, I can have 14 symbols. Symbols we had discussed, right? So slot size, it will always have 14 symbols. Here also it is 14 symbol. But what has happened? Just see, here in 0.25 millisecond, I am able to transmit 14 symbols. Here in 1 millisecond, I am able to do only 14 symbols. Here in 0.5, I am able to do 14 symbols. So just imagine that within 1 millisecond, I have 4 times, right? Suppose if it is 1 millisecond, then I have 4 times compared to the 15 kilohertz. So here, since slot duration is less, I have better latency and I am able to pack more data, rather 4 times data compared to this. So I think let me stop here and then perhaps repeat this in the next session. So tomorrow, our senior DDG, UK Srivastava sir, will take session on spectrum. And day after tomorrow, session on working of ITU. So these two sessions will be there. So next week we'll continue with the air interface part. Today, since session on IT was planned, but he got some meeting today, so he said requested for day after tomorrow. So day after tomorrow we had first session on air interface, which I shifted it today. So next week onwards we'll continue on the air interface. In the meantime, I'll be sharing certain documents. Please go through. And tomorrow and day after are important session for all of us. So let us go through. Thank you very much. And in case any more questions from anyone of you? Agar koi question ho kisi bhi tarike ka, aap pooch sakte hain.
Ashok?
Yes.
Achha, this network slicing, is it related to this concept also or not, what you have taught today? Last class we have talked about network slicing.
So different. Definitely. If suppose a network slice is made for a particular specific quality of service, so all these parameters, permutation, combination of these parameters will be required. So depending upon, for example, let me tell you one example, this will make clear. So suppose smart metering is one application. Smart metering is one of the application. So for that applications, what will happen is that connection density is the important parameter. Coverage, deep coverage is the important parameter. To have deep coverage, you require a lower side of the band and lower side of subcarrier spacing, that is numerology. So 15 kilohertz numerology, 400 megahertz spectrum, and connection density required is more. So the slice which will be for smart metering has to cater to this requirement. So yes, it is related.
Okay. Is there any relation between numerology and order of QAM modulation?
Yes, you are right. So basically, so how you use higher order of numerology? So to use higher order of numerology, you require better signal so that you are able to, so you are having multiple points on the same signal, right? So you need to decode that. So unless you have a good reception, you may not be able to decode a higher order of modulation. So that's how what happens if the person is very, very far away, his signal strength will be less. So to that customers, the QAM used is very, very, maybe QPSK or 16 QAM, depending upon level of reception. So that means if I have lesser coverage, so for example, onto the higher band side, it is for capacity requirement. So there I will, because all the customers are very near, so the reception level will be better. So wherever I have good reception level, that generally will be in a lower coverage area. If I have lower coverage area, I'll have better reception for most customers. So there I can use higher order of the modulation. Even if customer is suppose slightly away, but line of sight is clear and his reception quality is good, there also I can give a higher order of modulation. So higher order of modulation will depend upon the signal quality. It's not that it is 15 kilohertz or 60 kilohertz, not exactly related. But since the higher frequency band will be used for the lesser coverage area or indoor coverage, for example, if the BTS is inside your house on say 6 gigahertz frequency and your coverage is 200, 300, so within that room itself will get good coverage. So there I can use 256 QAM very easily. So it has relation with band, but primarily it is the quality of reception of the signal.
Okay.
Sir, one, it's regarding quadrature QAM modulation. Sir, as we go on higher order modulation, say 256 or 512 QAM modulation, the symbol error rate will be probably higher. So some specific error correction and detection techniques are being used in this kind of transceivers?
Yes, yes. So lot of such techniques are used. So in 5G, so basically 5G, the coding used in 5G is different compared to the different coding techniques used in even LTE. So they have there are two problems. So if you use in a coding, where is the overhead increases? So coding is what? So coding is basically you add additional bits so that when you decode, you are able to recover it. So more and more code overhead you'll add, your actual bit rate. So although the radio bit rate will be higher because it also contains the overhead, but the customer data rate will be less. So one has to choose even the efficient coding techniques. So in 5G, they have used certain efficient, for example, for signaling, they use polar coding, and for data, they use some other coding techniques. So yes, it depends. So any more question? There appears to be some hand raised. So if you want to speak, please go ahead. Harvesh ji, sir, have hand raised. So if you have any question. Okay, if there's no more questions, so thank you very much. Thanks a lot for joining.